Good morning. Welcome to St. Helena's today for the Eucharist. Welcome to those inside church. Welcome to those sitting and listening from the courtyard. Welcome to those who continue to join us online. And I think Akash may be one of those following us online. He and his family watching us now from Pakistan. So we greet him as well. Next Sunday is Harvest. I shall actually be in St. John's de Rigne doing Harvest there. Father Jeff and Anne will be the clergy leading Harvest here. We've invited you to bring gifts of dried goods and canned goods, and those will be distributed after the service. But do, I hope, please remember to bring some of those gifts as part of our Harvest offering this year. On Wednesday of this week, we have once again the book sale in the courtyard. Always a lovely sociable occasion, so if you're able to come along to take part, please do. If you're able to come along slightly earlier and help set up, that you would be very welcome to do that as well. A slight change to the hymns that you have helpfully printed on the pew leaflet this morning. You will notice if you look at the hymn board in church that the first and second hymns have been switched around. The hymn board is correct. So the first hymn we're going to sing is the second hymn on the notice sheet. It's 161. When you look at it in the hymn book, it has 8 verses. We're going to sing the first 4 verses and the last 2 verses. So we're going to omit verses 5 and 6, singing a total of 6 verses. I hope that is clearly expressed and clearly heard. Let's begin our worship with the first hymn, number 161.
Thank you.
turn to the communion service book. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please sit for the prayers of penitence. As we prepare to celebrate the presence of Christ in word and sacrament, let us call to mind and confess our sins. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We stand to say together the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. And the collect prayer for today, the 16th Sunday after Trinity. O Lord, we beseech you mercifully to hear the prayers of your people who call upon you, and grant that they may both perceive and know what things they ought to do, and also may have grace and power faithfully to fulfill them. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
The Old Testament reading is from Ezekiel chapter 18, beginning at verse 1. The word of the Lord came to me. What do you people mean by quoting this proverb about the land of Israel? The parents eat sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. As surely as I live, declares the Sovereign Lord, you will no longer quote this proverb in Israel. For everyone belongs to me, the parent as well as the child, both alike belong to me. The one who sins is the one who will die. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is not just. Hear, you Israelites, is my way unjust? Is it not your ways that are unjust? If a righteous person turns from their righteousness and commits sin, they will die for it. Because of the sin they have committed, they will die. But if a wicked person turns away from the wickedness they have committed and does what is just and right, they will save their life. Because they consider all the offences they have committed and turn away from them, that person will surely live. They will not die. Yet the Israelites say, the way of the Lord is not just. Are my ways unjust, people of Israel? Is it not your ways that are unjust? Therefore, you Israelites, I will judge each of you according to your own ways, declares the Sovereign Lord. Repent, turn away from all your offences, then sin will not be your downfall. Rid yourselves of all the offences you have committed, and get a new heart and a new spirit. Why will you die, people of Israel? For I take no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares the Sovereign Lord. Repent and live. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The appointed psalm is 25. Please join me in saying the verses in bold type. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Do not let me be put to shame. Do not let my enemies exult over me. Do not let those who wait for you to be put to shame. Let them be ashamed who are wont only treacherous. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all day long. Be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and of your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me. For your goodness' sake, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore he instructs sinners in the way.
Second reading is taken from Philippians 2, verses 1 to 13. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should not look only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but how much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act accordingly to his good purpose. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We sing the hymn now, number 69.
Hallelujah. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. You have the words of eternal life.
Hallelujah.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus entered the temple courts, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him. By what authority are you doing these things? They asked. And who gave you this authority? Jesus replied, I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I'm doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or from men? They discussed it among themselves and said, if we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say from men, we are afraid of the people, for they all hold that John was a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we don't know. Then he said, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, son, go and work today in the vineyard. I will not, he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, I will, sir. But he did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted? The first, they answered. Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth. The tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him. This
is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
I pray that I may speak in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I was a perfect child. Ask anybody. No, ask my mother. Don't ask my brother or my sisters. I can remember plenty of occasions as a child when I would be sitting reading, buried and absorbed by my book, and my father would come in and ask me to carry out some task, and I would mutter okay and carry on reading the book, probably not even remembering what the task was, and then he would return later and there would be consequences. The story Jesus told in the second part of the Gospel connects me to that memory of my experience of childhood. Jesus tells the story, as placed by Matthew in the Gospel, as a way of pointing out to the religious leaders who are testing him with increasing antagonism that they are behind the tax collectors and prostitutes on the way into the kingdom of God. Sinners are repenting and turning towards God with their lives, but the religious leaders, despite their words, are failing to respond to his teaching, just as they failed to respond to the teaching of John the Baptist. And later, Jesus will go on to condemn the religious leaders even more openly as hypocrites and blind guides. You'll see from the passage that Jesus avoids openly identifying himself with God by posing a question for them to answer. But more and more, by his teaching, he is provoking them to a reaction. There's a clear link between our three readings this morning. In Ezekiel, the prophet is calling on the people to repent, to turn and live by coming back to their covenant with God in faithfulness. And for Jesus too, as conveyed by Matthew's Gospel, the time is critical. The relationship to God is being damaged by the blindness of people to God's generosity and mercy, their deafness to the words of his prophet John the Baptist, and now to the words of Jesus himself, God's Son. We can actually stop there in our understanding of this parable, drawing attention only to the difference between saying and doing, profession and practice, the difference in the reception of teaching by sinners and its rejection by the religious. But I want to stay a bit longer with the parable, because it's not the only occasion on which Jesus used stories of a father and sons to illustrate his teaching. Think of Luke's Gospel and his telling of the story of the prodigal son. And Matthew will follow this parable with another story of a landowner who was having difficulty in collecting rents from his tenants. His servants had been abused, so he sent his son in the expectation that that relationship will be expected. In the story Jesus tells, and that we heard this morning, there is an obvious mismatch between the words of the sons in response to their father and their subsequent actions. Whenever Jesus uses stories of a father and sons, he is teaching about the covenant relationship of God with the people of Israel, their bonds of faithfulness and loyalty. There is to be obedience, but it is obedience within the setting of a relationship, not simply obedience for its own sake, the rules are there to help the relationship work. Trustworthiness and integrity are vital to healthy relationships within families, in marriages, between co-workers, between nations. I read earlier this year a book by Jonathan Sacks, the former chief rabbi in Britain. It was published only this year as well. The title of the book is simply one word, morality. And he writes about covenants and relationships. In the book, he analyzes contemporary culture and society, economics and politics. And what he's doing is addressing individualism. He's showing how over the past century and a half, there has been a move towards me as an individual and away from we as a community who hold together, away from the community to the individual. And he shows how many writers, experts in their own fields, recognize that this is actually damaging and unhealthy. Unhealthy to our economics, unhealthy to our culture, unhealthy to our politics, unhealthy for the way society works. In religions, at their best, and particularly in Judaism, in Christianity, and in Islam, there is an emphasis on family and community relationships and values, on compassion and kindness. All of us faithfully want to say that this is the true glue for holding together healthy societies, for creating the circumstances for human flourishing, rather than the rules and legislation or values derived from a market economy. A valuing of relationships and individuals affirms them and builds them up, rather than simply seeing people as consumers, customers, or units of production. Much that happens in our society is not particularly interested in us as growing, developing individuals. Much that happens in our society does not assist the building of community. So in the pattern of family relationships and friendships is a kind of model of how a better way of being human can be offered and participated in and shown. A relationship rooted in faithfulness and trust is the pattern of the faithfulness of God's covenant relationship with us. A relationship that will be energized by the constant love we recognize in God. It will be purposeful, obedient to God's will. It will be marked by gracious giving and grateful receiving. It will be mutual, because that's what a covenant is. Both parts contribute. And it will be characterized by an offering of ourselves. As I said earlier, I was a perfect child, but according only to my mother. Relationships among human beings will always be a work in progress, will always require honesty and patience and the readiness to recover from failures, to turn and readdress what is essential. When our relationships work like that, our relationships with each other, our relationship with God, there will be a harmony between words and actions, between what we say and what we do. And it's such relationships that everyone should aim at, whether scribe or Pharisee, tax collector or prostitute, or even us. And I said all three readings connect well today. That's the connection to make to our New Testament reading from Philippians, and I finish by reading just a few words from it. If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing of the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Amen. We now turn back to the communion service booklet, and on page 6 we stand so that we can say together the creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated for the prayers.
Dear Lord, as we in St. Helena's celebrate the Holy Eucharist this morning, we now join together in prayer and ask that you come into our hearts, our souls, our minds, and our whole being. We thank you for your Church here on earth, all clergy and laity who minister, shepherd, and support us in our faith and life. Thank you for the service and commitment of Archbishop Michael throughout the Diocese of Cyprus and the Gulf. We also remember all those who plan and lead retreats and quiet days across the diocese, and all who give and receive skilled spiritual direction. We're especially thankful for the ministry team at St. Helena's, Archdeacon Christopher and Assistant Priests Anne and Jeff. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, may they receive strength, courage and direction in all the works they undertake, and keep in their minds, your will be done. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, we pray for the leaders of countries and nations throughout the world. At this time, there are so many issues faced: COVID, migration, climate change, and its implications of storms, floods, drought and fires. As the negotiations relating to Brexit continue and new trading agreements between nations throughout the world are developed, give all leaders your support in their deliberations. We think especially of the island of Cyprus and continue to pray for a fair and respectful resolution to the North and South issues. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our
prayer. Lord, we give thanks for our lives, the places we live, our friends, our neighbours, the people we meet, and all the benefits we receive in this life. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for all those people in the world who are worse off than ourselves. We think of those affected by war, terror, oppression, disease, and disaster. We remember especially those people classed as migrants or refugees. At this time, COVID-19 is in everyone's thoughts, and we pray for all those who are in any way affected by it. We ask your blessing on those scientists and volunteers who are working for the delivery of an effective vaccine. We continue to pray for those affected by the tragic disaster in Beirut. Send your Holy Spirit to give them comfort and peace. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for those people who are ill, in body, mind, or spirit. In the quietness of our own hearts and minds, let us take time to remember those known to us who need help. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, send them all your blessings to support them in dealing with their illnesses. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for those people who have died. Again, in the quietness of our hearts and minds, we remember our family members, our neighbors, and friends who departed this life. May each of them have eternal rest, peace, and life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Finally, we thank you, Lord, for those who have spread your gospel on earth. We remember especially on this island of Cyprus, St. Paul and St. Barnabas. We thank you for the conversion to Christianity of our patron saint, Helena. We also remember all those ministers and lay people who throughout our lives have guided us along our journey of faith. May we, like them, be true ambassadors for you on this earth, throughout our time on this earth. Merciful Father, accept our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We continue our practice of observing physical distance between each other in the way we share the peace. We share it by a wave, a hand gesture, a smile that extends to the eyes as we turn and look at each other. And we also don't take up a collection by moving around you. We invite you to put an offering at the end of the service in the bowl near the door. So do please now stand for the peace, and we will turn and wave to those outside as well, and maybe even wave to the camera there. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let's offer each other a sign of peace. The hymn now, while the altar is prepared for communion, is number 401. after the offertory prayer, I shall use the first Eucharistic prayer. Wise and gracious God, you spread a table before us. Nourish your people with the word of life and the bread of heaven. Amen. The Lord is here.
He is here.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who is sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. We turn now to page 14 for the Lord's Prayer. Would you please be seated? Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Thank you.
Lord God, you have taught us through your Son that love is the fulfilling of the law. Grant that we may love you with our whole heart and our neighbours as ourselves, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Would you please stand for the prayer of blessing? The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Our final hymn this morning is number 240.
Thank you.
accommodating now.
They're all away.
Where are they away to? What
a
churchy thing.
Oh, I better ring up Sue then, because just in case.
Well, no, she'll be all right. God, I don't think Dinny is blown away.
I'll give her a ring.
Yeah,
she won't be ill though, but she'll have done something maybe for the horses.
I'm going to be here next time.